Good morning, church family. Happy Sabbath. Welcome, one and all, guests and members. We are glad you are here. It's the end of a year. It kind of feels like the end of an era, but we are glad to be welcoming in a new year on a Sabbath day together. So we invite you to sing with us and praise God together with us today.
Stand.
What if it turned into light? Open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you. None like you. Into the darkness you shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you, none like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Ashes we rise. There's no one like you, none like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? What could stand against? Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than is healer, awesome in power, our God, our God. And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? What could stand? God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God.
May be seated.
Soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning, it's time to sing Your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy.
Hit the ground.
What treasure waits within your scars? This gift of freedom gold can't buy. I bought the world and sold my heart. You traded heaven to have me again. My heart beating, my soul breathing. I found my life when I laid it down. Upward falling, spirit soaring. I touched the sky when my knees hit the ground. Find me here at your feet again. Up in your love again, and my soul will dance on the wings of forever. Find me here at your feet again. Everything I am, reaching out, I surrender. Come sweep me up in your love again, and my soul will dance on the wings of forever.
Garden of prayer. If you have any prayer requests, I invite you to stand up here in the front.
Spirit alone.
Heavenly Father, as we all stand here as a church family, we all have our own problems and troubles. I know that there is at least one soul in this room that really needs you right now. So please, Lord, I ask you to be with that individual. And as the word is going to be spoken today, I hope that it will touch his soul and at least bless them. Please be with the pastors that are going to be preaching the word of God today and help them to calm their nerves and to give them their comfort. For all of our requests that are on our mind, whether it may be that we've lost a family member or that we are trying to get a better relationship with God, whatever it may be, please answer our prayer request. Lord, please also be with our families and friends during the holidays and to just guide and protect them. Please also be with each and everyone here throughout the new year. Please continue to bless them with many more in the new year, 2017. Thank you, Jesus, for dying on the cross for our sins. We love you. Amen. Amen.
Did I just hear a little girl in the back yell out, thank you? Did y'all hear that? That was quite cute. Anyway, praise God for the blessing of music, right? Thank you, praise team. Before I begin, I'd like to ask you to take out an offering envelope. If you don't already have one in your hand, you'll probably find one in the seat in front of you. And as you're doing that, I want to remind you of one of the announcements in the bulletin, though I would like to think that you're going to read all of the bulletin. Tonight, there is a special gathering at the Sim Home where they're going to have a New Year's Eve potluck and prayer service. So you are cordially invited to that. The address is even there, phone number, everything you need to show up and send out the old year, what is soon to be the old year, with some brothers and sisters in Christ. In lieu of the video, I'm here, because I'm going to talk a little bit about what that video would have spoken to anyway. Here at the Puyallup Seventh-day Adventist Church, we've adopted a rather basic, concise, and yet profound mission statement. What is it? To know Jesus and what? Share his love. To accomplish that mission sometimes requires, well, it always requires Christian stewardship. Stewardship is a word some of us have heard, some of us haven't heard. What is it? Even if we've heard it, sometimes we forget it. So I'd like to say this together and galvanize this in our minds. What is Christian stewardship? Let's say that together. Managing God's blessings, God's ways, for God's glory. In the realm of financial blessings, there are four main categories that we give to, and you'll notice on that envelope there, the first one is tithe, and we go on from there. We have offerings, building fund, and Christian education. Those are the four main giving areas we have here when it comes to managing God's financial blessings to us. That first one, tithe, is first for a reason. Tithe is not something we give. According to the Bible, it's something we return. Of course, everything we have belongs to God. But the tithe has a very, very special appointed purpose that God himself highlights in his word. And he says, 10% of whatever you have been increased, I want you to return that to me. So what happens here at Puyallup Church, you put tithe there, and that money goes away from here. It comes back in the form of pastors. Pastor Seth and Pastor Natalie and myself, we get our salaries, as do other pastors and Bible teachers throughout the world, from that tithe. That's how we are funded. And we truly appreciate that people are faithful in their tithe. Some of it stays here in the Washington Conference. Some goes on to the greater Northwest, some goes on to the whole North American division of Adventist Church, and some goes on to the worldwide mission. So we are certainly, by paying tithe, participating in global evangelism. Now, the next category you'll see is called offering up there. You see it here as the second item listed, local church budget. And that funds our resources for our local ministry. I'll elaborate on that a little later. The next fund you see is the building fund. Probably we came up with that because the word mortgage fund wouldn't be as endearing to people. But essentially, that's what we are doing. We are paying to keep this building. There are a couple of entities that graciously, generously loaned us some money so we could have this wonderful facility to have a school in, as well as church, hold church services and all of our ministries out of this building. So this is paying the mortgage. By the way, if you back up to offering budget, you'll see that for the year, we are at 91% as of today. I think we can push it over the top and exceed that today, don't you? For sure. The number on the left is the number received so far. The number on the right is our target budget. Back to our building fund. You can see again what we've received for the month and what we need to receive to make our full mortgage payment. I think we can finish the year with that one in the black as well, don't you? I think we can do that. We want this building not only for our sake, but it's an investment in our community as well. We've held community events here. For example, we have Vacation Bible School here. We invite people from the community. Not long ago, we had a homeowners association meet here. So we want our building to be available for us to reach our community as well as to have our own events. Now, the fourth one here is no less important, but it is Christian education. I am so glad to be a part of a church that doesn't refer to the school, but our school. Amen? Northwest Christian is our school. It has been Nelson Crane, and now it is Northwest Christian, and we have a special allocation called Worthy Student Fund that gives scholarships to students who financially otherwise could not make it here. We have about approximately 15, give or take a few, right now who are receiving monies out of that fund so that they can sit here in our classrooms and receive a good academic education and even more importantly, know about Jesus Christ through this facility right here. And you can see again where we are at. The number on the right is the number that we target for the year. So we have a little time left. We're doing okay right now. We could up that a little bit. You see it there. Again, we go back to the four main giving areas we have as we manage God's money. The one I want to highlight today is the one called offering, which you see here on your envelope as local church building or local church budget. That fund, among other things, pays for our evangelism. Whenever we put money into that fund, a certain percentage goes into different categories. One of them is the evangelism fund. We right now have a Discover Bible School going on. We have 125 people who responded to our mailing for Bible studies. So now we have 125 people who have responded to that, and many of them are taking ongoing Bible studies. Because we have money in that evangelism fund, because you have given to our local church budget. So the invitations to Bible studies were paid out of that fund. The Bible study guides have been paid out of that fund. Supplemental materials have been paid out of that fund. Also out of that fund, we have Bible workers, three Bible workers coming here to our church next week. They are partially paid out of that evangelism fund. Three young people who are here to help us with those Bible studies. And that's to prepare for our big meeting series in March. 5-week series where Sean Boonstra from Voice of Prophecy is going to be here at the Puyallup Fairgrounds, and we're inviting people from all over the greater Puyallup area to be there. The monies in that church budget, some of it will go into the evangelism fund, out of which we'll pay for that mass mailing and the supplemental materials we need to host that big series. We had somebody so eager about receiving their Bible lessons that they couldn't wait for the mail to deliver their next couple of lessons. They showed up here at our church office and asked if they could get their next couple of Bible lessons. People are eager around this area to know Jesus Christ, to know their Bibles, to know the answer to their deepest questions. Is there truly a purpose to life? Is there a God? What's he like? Because we give to local church budget, we are able to provide Bible workers and Bible instruction and reach those people and help them to know Jesus as we share his love. So thank you for your faithfulness. I'd like to ask the ushers to stand as we get ready to collect the offering. While they do that, children, you know your jobs. If you're visiting and you're a little one, just follow those kids. They will be collecting other money from us. That goes to our building fund, and they will bring it up here to the little church. And then just stay here, kids, because my wife has a story for you right after we collect the money, okay? Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you very much that you have decided to allow us to partner with you in this great work of sharing the news of Jesus' birth, his death, his resurrection, and his coming. Thank you for helping us to be faithful. Thank you for helping us to sense your smile as we are faithful in returning to you a portion of what you've given us. Please guide these funds, Lord, so they go to exactly what you want them to go to and be used efficiently. In Jesus' name, amen.
We'll wait for just a few more coming on up. Come on up. Don't be shy. Glad you're here. Good job, you guys. You're so good at this. Well, hello, everyone. I think we're just about ready to get started. Did you guys have a good Christmas? Raise your hand if you had a good Christmas. Me too. I'm so glad you did. And I'm really happy that each of you is here today with your families worshiping God. Glad you're here. How many of you have a dog? Raise your hand if you have a dog. Okay, so we have a few dogs up here. Well, Pastor Mike and Mickey and I used to have two dogs. Perhaps, I think we have a picture of them that's going to come up there. There they are. Their names were Shula and Reggie. And today, our story is about Shula. She's the fluffy one. You guys can see back there. She's the fluffy one, the smaller one. Before we had Reggie, and before, way before our son Mickey was born, we had Shula up there. One day, we decided to take her for a walk, because dogs need walks, right? And we were going to go on some of our favorite trails. Now, we had been on these trails many times, but Shula had never been on these trails. But she was a young dog, and we knew she would love this adventure. So we parked our car, and we set out together. At first, Shula stayed right beside us because she didn't know the area, but pretty soon, she ran on ahead on the trail. and she was checking out all the new and exciting sights and especially the smells. Dogs like to smell things, right? Have you ever seen them run down a trail? They look like they could run into something because their heads are down, their noses are on the trail, and their tails are up wagging so happily. Well, we were careful to keep Shula right in front of us. Well, even if she was a little farther in front of us, just so we could see her. There were snakes in the area, and there were some ponds along our pathway, and we really did not want her to get wet on this particular day. There were other days we would do that. Well, suddenly, we noticed that Shula was stopped and intently staring at something. We got a little bit worried, but we looked ahead where she was staring, and guess what we saw? A big, well, it kind of looks like a field, but do you know that that is not a field? It is a pond, but it kind of looks like a field, and I think with Shula and not really paying attention really closely, she thought it was a field. And in the field, there were some ducks swimming, but it looked kind of like they were just sitting on the grass to her. And we knew the ducks were not sitting on a lovely green field, but they were floating on a pond, and we called those ponds the Emerald Ponds. Well, we didn't want Shula to go in there. We knew she was looking at the ducks, and she thought they needed chasing, so we called her frantically, "Shula, Shula, come back! Come here, Shula! You want a treat? Come on, Shula!" Trying to get her to come back. Well, her desire, she wasn't very well trained at that point, and her desire to chase ducks was stronger than her desire to listen to us. So off she ran, even though we were still yelling, "Shula, Shula, come back!" Well, I'm not sure if she really wanted to catch one of those ducks, and if she had caught one, I don't know for sure what she would have done with it, but we can't all understand how dogs are thinking, right? Well, she took a giant leap off the little hill leading to what she thought was the green field, and she expected to land on solid ground and start chasing the ducks. But instead, she disappeared. Where did she disappear? She went under the water. Yes, and this is not Shula, but it's a picture of another dog that took a swim in one of those ponds. Well, she came back up out of the water, and she forgot all about chasing the ducks. She did a U-turn and started swimming right back to us. Now, something changed. We had been yelling and yelling, "Come on, Shula, come back, come back." But now, once she got on shore, we stopped telling her to come back, but she came anyways. And do you know what wet dogs do? They shake. That's right, Hanalyn. Who else said they shake? They do. They shake really hard. They shake every part of their body. And guess what happens? The water comes off. The green algae comes off. The stinky pond water. Did I already say that? It comes off, and it gets all over us. So we kept telling her, "Go away, go away." She must have been totally confused, because first we're saying, "Come here, come here." And then we're saying, "Go away, go away." But we knew the trail well, so we knew there was a creek close by. And we took her to this little mountain stream, and we gave her a little dunk in there and got most of the green algae washed off. But I can tell you, she did not like getting a bath in a cold mountain stream. But we didn't really like, even though we kind of laughed about the ducks, we didn't really like having a stinky wet dog in our clean car on the way home. We were eager to get back and give her a real bath with soap and water. Well, today is New Year's Eve day. That means tomorrow is the first day of what year? Do you guys know the new year? 2017, that's right. And we all have a whole bunch of adventures ahead of us, right? There's going to be all kinds of new things to do, and it's kind of going to be like taking a walk on a trail. Some of you will be going back to school. Some of you will be at home playing with your brothers and sisters or other family members. You'll be learning new things. You'll be having new decisions to make. And I just want to tell you today, as we start the new year, that I hope you'll especially listen to Jesus and follow the way that he has for you. Don't be afraid to be adventurous and try new things. Yes, did you want to say something? Oh, he has such a special birthday. That's way cool. So listen to Jesus this year. When you hear Jesus calling you back from maybe saying something mean about or to somebody, listen to him. When you hear Jesus calling you back from maybe lying, telling a lie, or not obeying your parents, listen to Jesus, okay? When you hear him calling you back from maybe having a fight with your brother or sister or with a friend, listen to Jesus. And especially listen to him when he says, I want to spend time with you, and I want to make you clean. Can you do that? Can you choose to listen to him this year and stay close to him? By doing this, you're going to avoid a lot of gunk and grime and green algae, and you will have lots of joy. Let's have a little Bible promise. I have one up there on the screen for you. And we'll make that our prayer before we go back to our seats, okay? You, Jesus, it's talking about, will teach me God's way to live. And being with you, Jesus, will fill me with joy. Thank you. Amen. And Happy New Year to all of you. You can go back.
Church family, we have, I think, one of the most exciting things happening on the last day of the year. Amen. This is Grace. She's a student here at Northwest Christian School. Many of you know her. I see lots of her friends in the audience attending today for her baptism. I had the privilege of getting to know Grace last school year when I first got here, and we did some Bible studies together, and it was so special getting to know her, because I can tell you, she is very passionate about her relationship with God. She believes in Jesus, and she shares his love every day. She follows our mission statement as a church. I remember last year she got the theology award for her class, and I was very proud of her. She's a smart student. She's a brave girl. She loves animals. She loves riding horses. She's a fun person to be around, a real sweetheart. So on this very special day, pending her baptism, may I ask for a motion to accept her as a new member into our church family? And a second? And let's give a hearty Puyallup welcome to Grace. So now, Grace, because you love Jesus and because you have chosen to dedicate your life to him and leave your old life in 2016 and enter a new life in 2017, I baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Mother yet, but someday. If any of you have felt that call, have felt God tugging on your heart to give your life to him, to leave your old life behind in 2016 as Grace has done, and enter a new life in this new year, I want to invite you to contact one of us pastors or contact one of the elders. Let us know if you want to take Bible studies and get to know Jesus as your personal Savior. Make that commitment in baptism to him. Let's pray together and bless Grace's new life. Dear Father God, I thank you so much for the powerful Creator that you are. I thank you for giving us Grace. I thank you for creating her
for making her special and unique, and for giving her all of the talents and gifts that you have given her. Thank you for the sweet, kind heart that she has and her commitment to you, Lord Jesus. I ask that you bless her and be with us as a church family as we help raise her and put our arms around her. May we support her as she grows and learns. May we continue to walk beside her as she gets to know you day by day and as she grows closer to you. May we be her brothers and sisters, her mothers and fathers, aunts and uncles, grandmas and grandpas. May we all be her family, Lord. And may we lead her closer to you each day. And if there's anyone here, Father, who needs to make that commitment, who is ready to take that step, be with them. Help them to pursue that relationship with you, God, and to make that choice in baptism to be committed to you forever. We thank you for a beautiful Sabbath day. In your name, amen.
Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Let me introduce myself to you. Even though I feel a sermon coming on, I promise not to preach. And if you want to know some secrets about your pastor, I'm his father-in-law. So I can tell you all kinds of secrets. And they have given me the wonderful opportunity to dedicate one of these beautiful little girls. I was just watching, come on up. I was just watching all the kids at the children's story and the baptism that was so nice. It brought back memories when I was baptized. And when I was a little kid, we did not have children's stories like this. And so that's nice to have that. I'd like to invite my wife to come up, the mother of our daughter, Angela. Thank you, folks, so much for being kind to this pastoral couple. And I would like to just share a little bit about Paige. We've spent a week here having lots of fun. And she'll jump on the couch and snuggle right in. And I looked up her name and found out what it meant. It means a young servant. Now that is a tall order to live up to. And I think of a Bible text, Mark 10:45, where Jesus says he did not come to serve, he did not come to be served, but to serve. I'd like for that text to be her text. As I was thinking about her, I came up with a short little poem. Each letter of her name stands for something, P-A-I-G-E. So Paige, let me see if I can get you to come here. There you go. P stands for patience. And that means she will always be kind. Are you patient? And then A stands for aware. And she is very much aware of what she's doing. So patience, aware, P-A-I, stands for ideal. Whenever she snuggles right next to me on the couch and she crawls up on my lap, she is the perfect friend, the ideal friend. P-A-I-G stands for glitter. She just has such a shiny personality. So it is P-A-I-G-E stands for endless. Well, as a grandpa, I just hope we'll be friends forever. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Gracious Lord in heaven, I lift up before you Paige, and I ask that you watch her every step as she begins her journey in life. I pray that you'll bless her mother and father and her two sisters as they set example after example of how to live and work and play, and as she learns what what it means to be a servant. So someday we can all be together as a family, endlessly. In Jesus' name, amen.
This is quite a high Sabbath, I would say. Baptism, couple baby dedications, and team pastor preaching. I think that's pretty cool. We have another dedication coming up, and I want to call Soraya's family to come for, well, at least the parents for now. Where's Mary? Okay. She is changing the baby. Okay. We haven't yet trained her in the whole art of scheduling and that kind of thing. But yes, we need to give that back to Grace. Grace, can you come over here? This is the young lady who was just baptized, and because you give to our local church budget, we're able to give people gifts like this. So here's your welcome formally into the Puyallup Church family. We're so proud of you, very proud of you. Thank you. So the baby dedication, let me do this now. What we really need Soraya here for is for the prayer. But we'll talk about all this stuff. I don't think she will mind. By the way, she's changing. That reminds me of a church. I actually saw this plaque above the diaper changing station in the men's room at a church I went to several years ago. And it was a quote from the book of Corinthians. "We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed." And I thought, I don't think that's what Paul had in mind, but it worked in that situation. Soraya Diatina. We want to call Mary up, the mother, and Colin, come on up, stand with me here. Soraya, and it's pronounced Diatina. Did I say that right?
Diatina.
Diatina. Yeah. Okay, that was a no. That was a polite way to say no. But these names are Tongan or Cook Island derivatives. So we have a girl with some good island heritage here. And Mary and Colin, we're so proud of you for making this step to dedicate her to God's service. You will see that she's only 2 months and 1 week old at this point. Of course, we have to put the grandpa's name there and the grandma's name. I remember when Eva called me about this dedication service to make the arrangements. You could just almost see light emitting from my phone because he's such a proud grandpa. When we've done a search on Soraya's name, here's what we find. Soraya is actually a form of Sarah, which means princess. And Diatina means sunshine in the Cook Island language. I can't remember what it's called. But when I put that together, I'm thinking of how Jesus said, "I'm the light of the world." So Jesus is the light. And then he calls people who believe in him his children. So that means Soraya is a princess because she's the daughter of the king of the universe, right? A daughter of a king is a princess. And she's a princess of light. And we are so glad that we could be a church family for you. We hope to see a lot of you. We have a great Bible class for little ones like this and start her out very well. And we are honored to pray with this family as they begin this journey with little Soraya. Shall we pray? Father in heaven, thank you so much that you share the miracle of life with us in this way. We raise up little Soraya to you, Lord. She belongs to you first and foremost, and her parents second, and the rest of the family. May you guide her through them and through us as a church family, so that she surely will know you, love you, and serve you. Thank you for every angel that will attend her every step through life's journey. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. All right, we're proud of you. There you go. God bless you. We're with you.
Good morning, church family. Happy Sabbath and Happy New Year. I want to welcome you to Puyallup Seventh-day Adventist Church, and it is so nice to see all of you. It's so nice to have my family in town. And I'm going to tell you, it is hard preaching on vacation, which is why I've asked Pastor Mike and Pastor Natalie to do it with me, so it's a little bit easier. This is the last day of 2016. We are on the eve of another mission, a whole new year with opportunities to tell people about Jesus, to know Jesus, and to share his love. And our key text for reflection today, what we're all three going to be reflecting on, is Matthew 28, 19, and 20. And as has been our new tradition, I'm going to have you stand with me. We're going to read this together. The Word of God is meant to be read out loud, not just read in your head, not mumbled, not murmured, not whispered, but to be read boldly and to be heard. If you are joining us via live stream, audio, or video, go ahead and read with us. It doesn't matter if you scare the cat or the people in the living room or the car, wherever you're listening. Go ahead and read it with us with feeling. Ready? These are the words of Jesus to his disciples, all of us. Let's read it together. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age. Let's pray. Dear Jesus, we thank you so much. We have been abundantly blessed this Sabbath with so much new life and energy. So much family, so many friends. Jesus, thank you for giving us this church, this gathering place to come and know more about you and to share your love. We pray now that you fill our hearts and minds with your Holy Spirit. We live in a world of distraction and stress and anxiety and busyness, and it is sometimes difficult on Sabbath morning to focus, even in church, sometimes especially in church. Holy Spirit, guard our hearts and minds, protect us from all those stresses, all those anxieties, all those discouragements we've carried with us this year. Maybe some of the things that we're fearing for next year. Give us a Sabbath moment of peace to hear this word, to not just hear it, not just make it a beautiful theory, but to internalize it and put it into practice so we can know you and share your love. Jesus, we thank you so much for all the wonderful blessings. We pray all these things in your precious name. And we say, amen. You may be seated. 2016 has been a difficult year. We've seen a lot of people go. We've seen a lot of famous people go. Muhammad Ali, Prince, David Bowie, Nancy Reagan, Patty Duke, Carol Brady, Mrs. Brady from the Brady Bunch, Gene Wilder, Willy Wonka. And just when you thought the year was over, in this last week, singer George Michael, Carrie Fisher, Princess Leia, and the very next day, Princess Leia's mom, Debbie Reynolds. And not just famous people, these personalities who have a global stage, but as a community, as Puyallup Seventh-day Adventist Church, just our little space here on planet Earth, we've had some losses this year too. We've had to say goodbye. We watched some of our loved ones go. People like Bud Bachman, Kathy Butterfield, David Casebolt, Nikki Cutler, Vreonia Jenkins, Corbin Parker, Jerry Myers, Eleanor Pratt, Lillian Resick, little Noah Russell, Judy Smetana, and even a former pastor, Larry Zahosky. I don't know that I'm going to celebrate the new year so much as celebrate the death of the old one. Whenever we see people close to us go, it sort of ushers in this experience of reflecting on where we're going. And we are going. We go a lot of places. We go to work, we go to school, we go to church, we go shopping, we go on vacation, we go online, we go so much we go crazy. And if we're lucky, occasionally we get to go to bed. And then we get up and go all over again. So Jesus, knowing that we are going, gives us these words to tell us where to go and how to go. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations. Baptize them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Teach them to observe all that I have commanded you, and behold, I'm with you. I am with you always, even to the end of the age. When we read this passage literally in the original language, go is not a command. Jesus actually says, as you go, or while you're going, do these things. It's assumed that if you are a follower of Jesus, you are going to be going. It's kind of like when your mom asks you, can you clean your room? She's not really asking you a question about whether you want to or if you're capable of cleaning your room. She's telling you. Even though this isn't a command, it carries the same weight. As you are going, you will be going. Thank you for going. Continue to go. If you are a follower of Jesus, it follows that you will go. One of the most insightful comments made about Adventist Christian subculture came from one of our lay leaders this year. I heard it through the grapevine. They said, the Adventist Church or Seventh-day Adventists have a nominating committee mindset. Someone has to personally ask us to go before we will go. For those of you unfamiliar with nominating committee, it is a practice in a lot of Adventist churches where every year we elect a group of people who we think can make others feel bad enough to get involved. It's not quite that bad sometimes, but I have seen some things and I have heard some stories. And so we call people up and we say, look, can you just give me a year? Can you give me 2 years? And then you don't have to do anything ever again. Just can you please help us out here? And so, yeah, sure, I'll volunteer. And it's the strange dynamic that we call going for Jesus volunteering, as though it's optional. As though we have this option. You know, Lord Jesus, I thank you so much for the free gift of salvation, but I'm going to be really busy between now and the time I die. So if you don't call me, unless it's to call me back from the dead, because I don't want to miss that. But don't call me in between, because I'm really busy. We fall into two traps, two mindsets. The first being that we think this is optional, as if going for Jesus is something we can elect to do or not to do if we're a Christian. And so going for Jesus takes a back seat to going to work, to going to school, to going to play, as if, number one, that going for Jesus and these other things have to be mutually exclusive. They don't. But what happens is we end up chasing after all these other things except the one thing we're supposed to be going towards. There's this little memory verse we teach people, our little kids, when they're growing up. If you've grown up in church, you know it. Seek ye first the kingdom of God, and then what? All these other things shall be added unto you, but we put it backwards. We seek after everything else. We don't have time to seek after God. The other thing that happens is that there are those of us who go for everything. There's the one group that feels that it's an option, and there's the other group that says, look, I feel guilty. I have to go and do absolutely everything, and they burn out. They absolutely burn out. And so on the one hand, these people who think it's an option are going crazy with all these other things, so when they do feel the prompting of the Holy Spirit or someone from church does call them for something, they feel absolutely panicked and overwhelmed. And then the person who's been going for everything burns out in a year or two, and they think, man, ministry is so not worth it. Going for Jesus is so not worth it. It is so stressful. I don't want to ever do that again. And so they become part of the first group. The going is an option, and they chase after everything else. And it's not so much that ministry burnt them out as their own intemperance. See, what happens is you can fill your life full of going for Jesus, but that doesn't mean you're going with him. You don't carve out any time to sit down and prayerfully reflect or meditate or contemplate. Is this what I am called to do? Is this what I'm supposed to do? Jesus, can you fill my heart with the Holy Spirit to equip me and empower me to do what you've called me to do? We don't do that. We just go in our own strength. We might be going in the right direction, but we're not going with the right person. And so bottom line is nobody is called to do everything, but everyone is called to do something. And there are those of us this morning who need to slow down and prayerfully consider the one or the two things God has called you to do, and to do them with Jesus and to do them well. And then there are those others of you, you need to step up. Even if you have a title in ministry at your church, you are not experiencing the rewards of it, and nobody else is, because you have not thrown your heart and soul into it. You're just limping along. You are not stepping into your calling. And then there are some people saying, I don't know what I'm called to do. Well, I have good news for you. There are three pastors on staff, and these three pastors, our calling is to help you discover what your calling is. So make an appointment, and we'll help you out. Sometimes we read this, making disciples and preaching and teaching and baptizing. That seems very clergy-ish. It's a pastor thing to do. But the bottom line is it's all of our responsibility. It's for everyone in our own unique ways. In our own unique ways to share Jesus, to know him, to tell people there is a loving God who gives us grace and who has this tremendous purpose and mission for everybody that transcends all the temporal things that we chase after. We all do this in our own unique way. 2017 is going to bring with it a lot of opportunities to go in the wrong direction. And it's going to bring with it opportunities to go for Jesus and with Jesus in the right direction. It is time to start praying and committing to stepping into your calling. Don't wait for someone to call you on the phone or send you an email telling you to go. Jesus told you 2,000 years ago to go. So go.
Turn on my mic. I want to publicly thank our lead pastor. It's been a privilege to serve with him, along with Pastor Natalie, for another year. I am looking forward to the year to come, and I appreciate his decision to end 2016 and begin 2017 by looking at this commission from Jesus. I think it's a great idea. Before I begin, I'm going to give the same apology I gave in first service. Pardon me if I uncustomarily do a lot of looking at my notes, but I'm relegated to a certain amount of time, and I have really looked at this passage, and I am very adept, a little bragging here, I'm very adept at going all over the place with this passage, okay? So to help us all and give Pastor Natalie her time, I may do that. But before I do that, I think it's good for us to read this again. So if you would, let's read this great commission from Jesus again together. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age. We've looked at that word go and considered the meaning behind it. I chose the word therefore. This word that both points backwards as well as forwards. It points us to what precedes it before what proceeds from it. Therefore. I had an English teacher that said something like, that word tells us that we're coming to an explanation of what the portion of words immediately preceding it is there for. So it answers the why question. Go? Why? Therefore says because, and it points to what Jesus had just said before giving this great commission. What did Jesus say just before this particular portion? Verse 18 says, Jesus came to his disciples and said, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Think of that. All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go. But didn't Jesus already have authority as God? You've heard the words. If you were here for last week's sermon, Pastor Natalie pointed out, the words that begin John's story, John the disciple's story of Jesus. John chapter 1, verse 1. You've heard it. You know it. If you were here last week, you heard it afresh. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And we know from the context that the Word is Jesus. We drop down to verse 14. The Word became flesh and lived for a while among us. So, of course, that begs the question. If Jesus was God, if Jesus is God, as such, didn't he already have all authority in heaven and on earth? Well, the short answer to that question is yes. If yes, then why did Jesus speak of full authority being given to him by the Father? Why did he just say that? Why didn't he just say, as God, I have all this authority? Why did he talk about being given this authority from the Father? Well, while the detailed answer is yes, as we go on to read the Bible, especially, I would say, in the second chapter of the book of Philippians and the first 3 to 5 chapters of the book of Hebrews, we discover some interesting detail about this. Although Jesus has always been God and always was God and always will be God, he for a time forfeited his power and his privileges as God to save humanity. He never stopped being God, but what he did stop was enjoying the privileges, the prerogatives, i.e. the authority of God for a time to save us. Thus, the authority he speaks of in Matthew 28, as we're reading here, was conferred upon him by the Father in divine recognition and endorsement of Jesus' accomplished mission to live a life of perfect obedience to God's ideals and then to die as sinful, rebellious humanity deserved to die. Because of his completed task, Jesus returned to life and he received God's full authority, which he had previously relinquished or laid aside in order to take our human nature upon himself. And as we read in this scripture, it is by this authority that Christ's followers are instructed to teach others to observe everything that he has commanded. So to sum up my understanding of this word therefore in the Great Commission, I'd say it points to the entire work of Jesus to save you and me and every human being ever to live, to save us from a life of mere existence, and a temporary one at that, to a life of true abundance, and one that lasts forever. Since therefore points back to the authority of Jesus that he received, it also alludes to why he received it, meaning it points to every facet of the mission that he had accomplished. And those facets are, well, think of it. Number one, his indescribable condescension from his divine form, his divine authority, his divine home, to step down from all of that to become a human embryo, a dependent little baby, and ultimately a mature human male that experienced the worst that humanity can throw at someone. And number two, it points to his incomprehensible willingness to sacrifice himself, even though he knew he had lived a life of perfect obedience to God, never strayed from God's ideals, not even in a thought. And he knew that he had accomplished that. He knew he was innocent of any kind of wrongdoing, and yet he took on the guilt of all human beings, every violation against God and each other. And he did this even to the point of a literally heart-crushing agony that caused his death. Also, he did all of this after enduring terrible beatings and being hung on a cruel wooden cross. And I would say, in light of the deaths that Pastor Seth spoke of, and it's his death and resurrection that fortifies us to deal with all the death that is around us. therefore provides a reminder of not only Jesus received authority to lovingly command us, but also that word is a reminder of how Jesus earned that authority. It points to the incredible cross experience, as I like to say, the incredible cross experience of Jesus. That vivid picture of Jesus suffering to earn our right to heaven. I believe if it were to be hung in the very center of our hearts, in the very center of our inner vision, it becomes a strong and even irresistible motivation for knowing God and sharing His love. If that becomes our main focus, our most consistent focus, I believe it really becomes a strong and even irresistible, if it stayed there, motivation for knowing God and sharing His love. First, we realize what He's done for us, and then we sense the urge and the fortitude to tell others the good news. Think of it. Many of us could wish that we had an endless supply of money. You have this amount of money, and no matter how much you take out of it, there's still a whole lot in it. That'd be pretty cool. That'd be pretty cool. This building would look different. It would be added to. All kinds of things would happen. But what about power? I believe I'm looking into the faces of people like me who wished they had more power. More power to carry out the things we know would benefit us, would benefit other people, we know would glorify God. We may even know God is calling us to, and yet we sense this lack of power to do. We may lack the sense of power to go. Somebody here may be thinking, well, I heard what Pastor Seth said, and I want to, I don't have it in me right now. The Apostle Paul tells us in the book of Corinthians, the first chapter, his first letter to the Corinthian church, chapter 1, verse 18, he says, the message of the cross is the power of God. Is God's power limited? Not at all. Not at all. It is limitless. The message of the cross is the power of God. What if we thought of that message every day for a good solid portion we spent time, even if it was 10 minutes every morning, just focused on the cross of Christ, absorbing the power of that message of how deep His love is for us. One of the Adventist Church's foremost founders, Ellen White, went to Australia in the late 1800s, and from there she wrote many letters. In one of her letters that she wrote to Edson, her son, and her daughter-in-law, his wife, she ended this letter that she sent from Australia back in 1898 this way. These were her last two sentences in this letter. We behold in the cross of Christ our efficiency, our inexhaustible source of power. Our inexhaustible source of power. Here we may well be ambitious in behalf of Christ. Do you see how she coupled that? The same thing that Jesus is doing here in the Great Commission. Coupled the message of the cross with this commission to go and represent Him. It's the therefore. It's the motivation. So what does it look like as I conclude here? What does it look like at the Puyallup Seventh-day Adventist Church to take on in our hearts the message of the cross, to take on the therefore in Jesus' commission? Well, what does it look like here as I reflect on this year? We visit our own church members when they are sick, despondent, or just unable to physically join the rest of us in our gatherings. In fact, we have a group of committed church members here that form a pastoral visitation team who regularly do this. We knock on the doors of those who respond to our mailed invitations to study the Bible, and we even sometimes study weekly with those same people. We answer God's call to fill His appointed role for us in the body of Christ, His church, and thereby we become Bible class teachers and deacons and deaconesses and audiovisual people and office assistants and extraordinary financial donors and musicians and a host of other roles. We give our money regularly to foster the operation of our church and our school and even world missions. We reach into our community by going on charity motorcycle runs, providing food, and even recently obtaining a trailer to provide a safe haven for an otherwise abused woman and her child. This is how we know Jesus. This is why we share his love. We remember what Jesus did, and therefore, we go.
Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations. I remember one evening looking up at the night sky in Jerusalem. And I've told you about this experience many times. In the distance, we could hear sounds of conflict. The air raid sirens had screamed just a few nights before. And I remember in the cool evening air with just a scarf around my shoulders, shaking and being nervous as we tried to contact our families to tell them we were all right. But at the end of that experience, I was all right. And in high school, after a mission trip to Africa, where I saw women my own age and much older than me, who pounded rocks into gravel to make just $1 a day, after seeing this, I was all right. And after I returned from Belize, where we gave shoes and socks to a little boy whose feet were bleeding and blistered, I was all right. And after witnessing the anger and hostility that sometimes still exists in modern-day Serbia and Croatia from people in those nations who don't like their neighbors very much, I came home and was still all right. And after traveling through the war-torn Middle East, I came home safe. I was all right. But deep down, I knew that all these things were not all right. In my heart, God was speaking to me. I remember when I was looking up at the night sky, after going through these different experiences, thinking about them and the way God had moved in my life, I knew that it wasn't all right. And I felt God speaking to my innermost thoughts and telling me that I needed to go and do something about it. I felt that tug, that pull on my heart to go make a change, to go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything that God commands. I am with you always, even to the end of the age. These words echoed in my mind. Go, make disciples of all nations. All nations. So what did that mean for me specifically? What was my calling? What was my all nations? Was I supposed to go and be a missionary full-time in another nation? Or a pastor full-time in my own nation? Both thoughts equally terrifying. So I answered the call. Literally, I picked up the phone and answered, and Doug Bing told me, you're going to Puyallup Seventh-day Adventist Church. Previously, I honestly didn't know that there was a church in Puyallup, an Adventist church in Puyallup. I'd heard of some of the other ones in our conference, but I didn't know there was one here in Puyallup. All I knew of was the fair, which I went to every year growing up and had fond memories of.
But I came, and I remember touring through the building, looking at the school, meeting a few people here and there, and seeing the storage room that would become my office, and feeling excited and about this experience that I was going to have. I was anticipating, what was this place like? Who are these people? You know, what are they going to be like? Who am I going to meet? What is this church environment like? Who's a part of this church family? And exactly 364 days ago, I began this journey with you. And it's been a blessing. And I truly stand here a changed person because of the year that I have spent in this church. We have done so many things together. We have gone through so many experiences, both good and hard, together. And it's been the hardest year of my life. I think it really has been, hardest year of my life. But as I look into the audience, I see students who I get to play with at recess or see in the school building, kids I get to teach, whether they like it or not, people that I've worked with in VBS or different Sabbath school ministries or youth events, all the different things that we have done in this church family. But I also see the empty chairs. And as Pastor Seth mentioned, I miss those who we lost this year. We lost people as a church family. I lost some people in my own biological family. And it's been a hard year. It's hard to believe sometimes. 1 year ago, I stood here, a fresh graduate from college, a degree coming in the mail. I had a young, naive heart that was ready to serve people and go change the world. And looking back on this year, we probably all feel this way. I feel 100 years older and wiser in some ways, but with 1,000 more years of things to learn. At 23, I've looked death in the face, peered into its steely eyes, held the hands of its victims, sung to those facing it with tears in my voice, tried to explain it to children, rushed into hospitals only to find out I was too late, watched skin turn gray, and felt it turn cold as ice, touched the brow and cheek of those long gone already. We remember the fallen ones this time of year and reflect, for me at least, on the impact that they made on my life. But despite the depression that always seemed to be looming at the door this year, between the things that happened in our own church family and the things happening throughout the world, the wars, the many crisis situations that we saw in 2016, despite all of that, I am thankful and humbled. Thankful and humbled that God would place me in this church, that we would get to work together, that I would get to know you, that He would make this my calling. And I am amazed that He gives us over 150 little kids in the school to bless each day through ministry. I'm amazed that He gave me a church full of people who have very differing opinions and lifestyles, but truly know how to come together and be a family and honestly be one of the friendliest churches I have ever been a part of. Amen. And that's a real blessing. I feel so blessed. We are so blessed as a church family. And I am so excited to see what God can do through our church in 2017. So when He calls to your heart, the words that are on this screen, when He tells you to go, to make disciples of all nations, to baptize them, to teach them, to feed His sheep, all of them. Do you believe it? Do you really believe it? Do you listen to those words? Do you listen to His call on your heart? Do you trust that He could use someone like you? Do you dare to believe that He has something bigger and better than you could ever have imagined, planned for your life? Your age doesn't matter. whether you're 5 or 25 trying to figure out your life, 55 having a midlife crisis, or 85 wondering if there's even time left for God to do anything with you, it doesn't matter how old you are or what your age is, God still has a plan for your life. He has something amazing He wants to do through you this year. He has a life, someone out there who could only be reached by you. Only you. So who is the all nations that God is calling you to reach in 2017? Who is it? Isaiah 43 tells us, this is what the Lord says, He who made a way through the sea, a path through the mighty waters. Forget the former things. Do not dwell in the past. See, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs up. Do you perceive it? I am making a way in the wilderness and streams in the wasteland. I, even I, am He who blots out your transgressions for my own sake and remembers your sins no more. Even if your life at the end of this crazy year feels like a wasteland, even if you feel like all you can do is dwell in the past and the pain that this year has brought you, I want you to look to the future. Look to the future. God is doing a new thing. He has a new plan for you. He has given you another year, which is a blessing in and of itself. He's given you a new chance to make a change in your own life, a new chance to help others more, to follow Him more diligently, to reach others for Him. He is making a way in your wilderness and making streams in your wasteland. 2016 is over. The end of today, it's done. We don't have to go back there. Your sins and your transgressions of this past year, they're gone. He remembers your sins no more. So take this last day of the year to rededicate your life to Him, to let Him show you the great plan that He has for your life in this new year. We've got some cards in the back of the seats in front of you. I encourage you to take one now and write down that rededication prayer. Only the pastors will see these. You don't have to put your name on it if you don't want to. You can give it to the deacons at the door. But take a moment to take that card and write down, what is it that you feel like God is calling you to do in this new year? What is it that you felt for a while now, Him tugging on your heart, trying to convince you of? What is that thing that you know He wants you to do? Who is your all nations this year? Now let's stand together as I say a blessing that the Israelite priests would say over the children of Israel. Let's stand together and I'll say this over you today. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn His face toward you and give you peace. Amen. Dear Lord, we praise You and we thank You on this Sabbath day that we have come to the end of this year, that it's over and we don't have to look back anymore. Our sins are in the past. The mistakes that we made this year, the hurt that has seemed to follow us, Lord, these things are in the past, and now we have a chance to start afresh with You. I ask that You would help each one of us to rededicate our lives to You in this new year. Show us what Your calling is, God. There are different talents and gifts that You've given to each person in this room. I've seen them used this year, Lord, and I ask that in this new year, in 2017, that You would inspire us, that You would lead us, that You would guide us, that You would help us to know what it is specifically that You want us to do this year for You. Lord, maybe this is the year that You will come back We hope that it is. We are ready for that. But in the meantime, show us the path that you have for us. In your name, amen. Amen. Happy Sabbath and Happy New Year.